It's good to see you here tonight. If you're a guest, we are indeed delighted to have you to be with us. How many of you have been hearing in the news the advertisement about the event that's coming to the beach this weekend? Have y'all heard anything about that? Lift your hands. I think it's called Freaknik. Isn't that what it's called? And I do know that our sheriff is very, very concerned about that and the potential for some very bad things happening in our community, on our beach. And I'd forgotten to share with Brother Clyde to make sure that he mentioned that to us tonight. But I want to mention it. But more than mention it, I want to lead us in a prayer. And I want us just to ask the Lord to protect those that are involved out there this weekend. Would you join me as we pray together? Our Father, we are grateful for the gift of prayer. We're thankful, our Father, that we can make a huge difference by simply falling on our knees and calling upon your holy name. And our Father, we do want to pray about this event that's happening in our beach this weekend. And Lord, I pray for your protective hand to be upon the people that live in that area. Lord, I pray for those who have it in their hearts to come to this place for nothing but doing evil. Lord, I pray that you would spoil their plans. Lord, I pray that you would stop it. I pray for our sheriff, and I pray for all of our deputies, for all of our law enforcement personnel that will be involved watching over that. I pray, God, for your protective hand to be upon them. Lord, these are such crazy days that we live in, seeing things today that we never saw 30 years ago. And it seems like evil is getting worse and worse and worse. And yet, there's one thing that we as your people can do. We can always pray. So, God, we thank you tonight that you are hearing our prayers, and we thank you that you're going to move in response to the prayers of your people. And I pray that those who are out there this weekend protecting and serving, that they will feel the prayers of your people that are going up on their behalf. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you are a guest, we are teaching through the book of Genesis. And tonight I want to invite you to open your Bibles to Genesis chapter number 25. And we're going to look tonight at verses 19 through 34. And I want to talk to us on the subject of a tale of two sons. Genesis chapter 25, and I want us to go ahead and read these verses, and then we will come back and begin to kind of break this passage of Scripture down. But in Genesis chapter 25, beginning at verse number 19, the Bible says, "And these are the generations of Isaac, Abraham's son. Abraham begat Isaac. And Isaac was 40 years old when he took Rebekah to wife, the daughter of Bethuel, the Syrian of Paddan Aram, the sister to Laban, the Syrian. And Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife, because she was barren. And the Lord was entreated of him, and Rebekah, his wife, conceived. And the children struggled together within her, and she said, 'If it be so, why am I thus?'" In other words, if it's the will of God, why am I struggling with this? "So she went to inquire of the Lord. And the Lord said unto her, 'Two nations are in thy womb, and two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels. The one people shall be stronger than the other people, and the elder shall serve the younger.' And when her days to be delivered were fulfilled, behold, there were twins in her womb. And the first came out red all over like a hairy garment. And they called his name Esau. And after that came his brother out, and his hand took hold on Esau's heel, and his name was called Jacob. And Isaac was 80 years old when she bare them. And the boys grew, and Esau was a cunning hunter, a man of the field, and Jacob was a plain man, dwelling in tents. And Isaac loved Esau, because he did eat of his venison, but Rebekah loved Jacob. And Jacob sawed pottage, and Esau came from the field, and he was faint. And Esau said to Jacob, 'Feed me, I pray thee, with that same red pottage, for I am faint.' Therefore was his name called Edom. And Jacob said, 'Sell me this day thy birthright.' And Esau said, 'Behold, I am at the point to die, and what profit shall this birthright do to me?' And Jacob said, 'Swear to me this day,' and he sware unto him. And he sold his birthright unto Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and pottage of lentils, And he did eat and drink and rose up and went his own way. And thus Esau despised his birthright. Now, if you are like me, whenever you go out and you rent a movie, and the truth is, if you are like me, you probably don't rent a whole lot of movies. But if you do go out and rent a movie, you're probably like me in that the first thing that I do when I put it into the DVD player, the first thing that I do is to hit that fast forward button that I might bypass all of the previews and the trailers that deal with movies that are upcoming. And when I do that, what I'm saying basically is that I want to bypass this and I want to get to the main feature. Well, I really think that sometimes we come to verses in the Bible and that's what we do. We kind of know what's coming afterwards, so we hit the fast forward button and we kind of bypass some of those verses. But I think that we would make a tragic mistake if we were to do that for these verses, because actually what we have in Genesis 25 verses 19 through 34, it is simply a preview, an introduction, a trailer that kind of introduces the next 10 chapters that are going to follow. And we could entitle those next 10 chapters, The Life and Times of Isaac. And although we would entitle those 10 chapters, The Life and Time of Isaac, in reality, there's only one chapter about Isaac, and that's chapter 26, because the remaining chapters deal with one of Isaac's sons by the name of Jacob that we read about in this story. So what we have then is just a trailer in these verses pointing to a coming movie that we're about to look at for the next 10 chapters. But it's very important that we look at this trailer and we read the introduction, because if we don't understand some things that are happening here concerning Isaac's son Jacob, his brother Esau, and something about their birth, we're really going to be lost in a lot of the other material that is to follow. So that's why I want us to look at these verses tonight, even though they are basically an introduction. Now, the story begins down in verse number 19 with a familiar phrase if you've read through the book of Genesis, and that phrase is, "These are the generations of." We read that one phrase over and over again. As a matter of fact, "these are the generations of" appears 11 times in the book of Genesis. And really, the book of Genesis is a story that contains the telling of 10 successive generations. You know, generations come and go, but the one thing that remains constant in all of those generations that we read about in Genesis is the activity of God. In each generation, we have God creating and God leading, God guiding, God directing, God protecting. Even though generations come and go, yet the activity and involvement of God is always there. Kind of reminds me of Psalm 90 and verse number 1 that says, "Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations." And that's what we see throughout these 10 successive generations, is the activity of God within each of those generations. Now, the story opens for us with a focus on Isaac and Rebekah. Now, you know who Isaac was. You've been with us through this study. Isaac was that miraculous son born of Abraham when Abraham was 100 years old. And after his wife had been barren for some 90 years, then Isaac was born. And then remember, we looked a few weeks ago back in chapter number 24, where Abraham sent his servant out and found a wife for Isaac, and her name was Rebekah. Now, when Isaac and Rebekah were married, you'll remember that one of the points of that story was at the very ending of it, that the promise of God that had been given to Abraham, that he was going to bless his seed, that seed would be like the stars of the heavens and the sand on the seashore, and that ultimately the Messiah was going to come through that seed. Well, you remember that promise was reiterated and it was given to Isaac. And so Rebekah heard that promise, that her husband's seed was going to be like the stars of the heavens. Now, I can just imagine, after Rebekah heard that, she's thinking, you know what? I'm going to get pregnant pretty soon. Because if I don't, how in the world is all of this going to come to pass? But you know, from reading the story, it didn't happen that way. As a matter of fact, our text tells us that they had been married for 20 years now, and Rebekah still was not pregnant. In fact, Isaac was 60 years old at this point, and they still were not pregnant. Isaac's brother Ishmael had already fathered 12 sons, and old Isaac, he hadn't fathered any sons. And so I'm sure that they were getting a little concerned about this time. Now, I wonder, why was it that God waited for 20 years before Rebekah became pregnant? Well, I think it was because God was still trying to teach His people the same truth He was trying to teach Abraham and Sarah, and that is that the seed that was going to come through that line, which would be the Messiah, which would be a blessing to the entire world, was not something that could be produced by human effort, but it was going to require the involvement of God. If God didn't make it happen, it wasn't going to happen. And so just as it was true in the case of Rebekah's mother-in-law, Sarah, so also it was true in the life of Rebekah as well. Well, the Bible tells us as we study further that finally this birth did occur, and there were several things about this birth that I want us to take note of tonight. Number one, down in verses 21 through 26, and I'll come back and make references in a moment, but the first thing that I notice is that this was an extraordinary birth. An extraordinary birth. And it was extraordinary because of several things that were involved in this birth. The first thing that we see that was involved in this birth was an effectual prayer. Effectual prayer. And down in verse number 21, "And Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife, because she was barren. And the Lord was entreated of him, and Rebekah his wife conceived." In other words, God answered that prayer. Now, I have always been a student of prayer. I think that given the fact that when I was first saved, I was turned on to some books written by R.A. Torrey, who was a great man of prayer, and other great prayer giants of yesteryear. It just so whetted my appetite to want to be a man of prayer. And so Brother Paul Melvin has given me several books that he has read on prayer that have been such a blessing to my life. So anytime that I come upon a story in the Scripture where it's showing us about a prayer that was an effective prayer that really worked, man, I want to learn something about that kind of prayer. You know, what was it that made it effective? You know, I don't want to just live and call out to God, and it seems as if the windows of heaven are brass and the Lord's not listening to me. Man, I really want to be able to pray in such a way where I have a conviction that God's hearing my prayer and He's going to respond to that prayer. So there's some things about this prayer, I think, that bring that to light. And the first thing I would say about this effectual prayer is that it was passionate prayer. Down in verse number 21, that word entreated, I'm not sure how it may be translated. If you have a different translation other than the King James like I have, but that word entreated, it's an interesting word that indicates the idea of passion and of zeal. And the reason I know that is because that's the very same word that was used throughout the prayer life of Moses in Exodus chapter 7, verse through chapter number 10, where he is pleading with the Lord that he might remove the plagues. So it was passionate prayer. It wasn't a little, "now I lay me down to sleep" type prayer, but it was a prayer that had passion and it had fervor. Doesn't the Bible say over in the book of James that the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man or a righteous woman is the kind of prayer that avails much or literally gets much accomplished? So it was a passionate prayer. But I would say, secondly, it was a persistent prayer, because we asked the question, well, Pastor, how long did Isaac pray this prayer? Did he just pray at one time and stop? I don't think so, because in verse number 21, it says that Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife. Now, when did he do that?
I think he did that at the very beginning of their marriage because she was barren. And I believe that there is a gap of 20 years between that statement and the following statement that says that the Lord was entreated of him, and then Rebekah, his wife, conceived. So I don't think that Isaac just prayed one time, boom, God heard his prayer, and then Rebekah conceived. I think it was a persistent prayer over a long period of time, 20 years, in fact. Now, I'd call that persistent praying, wouldn't you? That's the kind of praying that God pays attention to. I'm always moved by the story of George Mueller, who prayed for 47 years for a lost brother. 47 years. Prayed for him every day. And then finally, that brother got saved. See, that's the persistent kind of praying I'm talking about. But there's a third thing there that I think is just implied, and that is I would call this patterned prayer. Patterned prayer. I think that Isaac learned to pray like that because Isaac patterned his life after his father, Abraham. And Abraham was a man of prayer. You know, over and over again when we read the story of Abraham's life, we read those great prayers of Abraham, calling out to God. You know, every time that Abraham moved, what was the first thing he always did when he got to a new place? Built an altar. And when he built that altar, what did he do? He fell on his face before God and he prayed. And friend, don't you think that Isaac was paying attention to that? I think that Isaac learned to pray like he prayed from his father. And I think I've told you before, but if there is one thing that I could do over again as a dad, when my children were young, I would teach them better how to pray. Now, I've tried to do that when they got to be older teens and as young adults. I try to teach my grandchildren the importance of that. When one of my grandkids comes to me and they've got a little problem they're dealing with, first thing I do is I say, well, now let's just stop and pray about it. Let's just pray about it. Try to teach them the importance of prayer. And I think that was one thing that Isaac learned, that he patterned his life after his father Abraham. But I think there's a fourth reason. Man, this is really the reason why this was such an effective prayer. And that is, it was what I would call proper prayer. And I would refer to this as proper prayer because here was prayer that was prayed in the will of God. Now, friend, that's the key to effective prayer. Praying in the will of God. And I'm going to show you that he did that in just a moment. But let me give you a couple of verses. 1 John chapter 5, verses 14 and 15. The Bible says, now this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, we know that we already have the petitions that we have desired of him. So if we are praying in the will of God, we can really pray by faith because we know that God's paying attention to that prayer. James chapter 4 and verse 3, the Bible says, you ask, but you do not receive, because you ask amiss in order that you may consume it upon your own lust. See, that's selfish praying. You say, now wait a minute. Isaac's prayer was a selfish prayer. His heart was heavy because his wife was barren. He wanted her to have a child. He wanted a child. He wanted this all for himself. That's why he prayed this prayer. Oh no, I don't think that is at all why he prayed this prayer. I think that Isaac prayed this prayer because Isaac had overheard his mama and his daddy over and over again talking about the covenant promise God had made to them that was going to be passed down to him, that through him, his seed was going to be like the stars of the heaven and the sands on the seashore. He knew the promise that God had given, that the Messiah was going to come through his seed. And he knew that if Rebekah did not have a child, that would be absolutely impossible and the promise of God would not come to pass. So he wasn't simply praying for a child because that was his own want, wish, or desire. He was praying for a child in order that God's plan would be fulfilled, God's will would be done, and God would be glorified. See, that's why he was praying. Friend, let me tell you what effective prayer really is. Effective prayer is when I am more concerned about God's will than my wants. More concerned about God's will than I am my wants. And there are so many times when I pray about something and I'll have to come before the Lord and I'll have to just honestly before Him say, now God, I want You to sift my motives. I want You to just sift through my motives. Now, you know, it may take me several days or weeks for God to be able to sift through my motives. Why am I asking for what I'm asking for? Lord, am I asking this because I truly believe this is the will of God and You can be glorified in this? Or Lord, is this just simply a selfish desire, you know, that I have? And I think that's one of the things that set Isaac's prayer here apart. So number one, we would say that that his prayer, that it was an effectual prayer. But there's a second thing about this story here that we see, and that is a tumultuous pregnancy. Now, I've never known of an easy pregnancy. You know, I've seen my wife go through three of those things, and glad it was her and not me. I've never seen an easy pregnancy, but I'll guarantee you this one wasn't easy. Down in verse 22, it says, the children struggled. And that word struggled in the old Hebrew literally means to be crushed or to be oppressed. And the children struggled together within her. And so she said, if this be so, if this is the will of God, then why am I experiencing this? So she went to inquire of the Lord. In other words, something was going on. The fetal movements inside her womb, they were not normal. You know, there was mayhem that was happening, you might say, inside of her body. And I like what Rebecca did here. I think that Rebecca thought, you know what? Maybe the Lord's trying to tell me something here. So the Bible says she inquired of the Lord. You know, isn't that a good thing to do when things are happening in our lives that we just can't quite figure out why they are happening? Maybe the circumstances of life are just not kind of going along like we think that they ought to go along. Isn't it a good thing at that point to inquire of the Lord and say, Lord, are You trying to tell me something? I think that's what Rebecca was doing here. Lord, are You trying to tell me something about this? Lord, are You trying to speak to my heart? You know, Isaac was a blessed man to have a wife that believed in prayer, but he was also blessed to have a wife that was concerned about God's will for her life and for her children. So, Lord, what are You doing here in my life? What are You doing here in the lives of the life of this one that's on the inside of me in my womb? And then God answered her and gave her what I call a perplexing prophecy. Because in verse 23, it says, the Lord said unto her, and boy, this would be a mouthful to hear, two nations are in thy womb, and two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels. And on the one, and the one people shall be stronger than the other people, and the elder shall serve the younger. In other words, he was saying, Rebecca, listen, the warfare that you're experiencing in your body has far-reaching results because you have twins inside of you. And when they are born, one is going to one day father one nation, and one day another will father another nation, and those two nations will constantly oppose and divide one another. And those two nations that those two boys would father, Esau, which means red, would be the father of Edom, and Jacob, which means to protect, would be the father of Israel. And when you read the rest of the Old Testament, you understand and see that that prophecy was true because those two nations constantly were battling against one another. But not only did she learn that, she also learned something else, I think very important. She learned that the conventional rights of the firstborn would be overturned as their roles would be reversed. That's what the Lord said down in verse number 23, the latter part of that verse. He said, and the older one is going to serve the younger. Now that was contrary to the conventional rights of that day. It was always the older one who was the one that received the birthright, the blessing, but it wasn't going to be the case in this situation. She learned that the tumult in her womb, it was not anything of hers or Isaac's making, but it was a part of a divine plan that God was sovereignly working out for His own purposes and His own glory. In other words, she learned something we need to learn, and that is that the order of nature is not necessarily the order of God. And God is not the one that's subservient to the order of nature. The order of nature is subservient always to the will of God. You know, this idea here about the reversal of the roles and the order, we find it consistently, repeatedly emphasized in the book of Genesis. For example, the older brother Cain had his offering rejected. The younger brother Abel had his offering accepted. The younger Isaac was chosen over the older Ishmael. Joseph, the youngest of Jacob's sons, was chosen over his brothers. You see, that was not the proper protocol of that day. But friend, God is not governed by man's protocol. And many times, God's ways are not man's ways. I thought of that passage when I was studying this out over in the book of 1 Corinthians, which says in 1 Corinthians 1, verses 27 through 29, God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. And base things of the world and things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and the things which are not, to bring to naught the things that are, so that no flesh should glory in His presence. Sometimes God does things completely opposite of the way that we would do things to show who is God and who isn't, that He might receive the honor and get the glory. You see, Jacob was chosen over Esau for one reason. Friend, it was God's will. It was God's will that the younger would rule over the elder was contrary to human tradition and to logic. But friend, that was God's sovereign choice. And if that was God's sovereign choice, then that was the right choice. But there's one more thing under this first point, and that is I would simply say that it was a dramatic birth. Man, I mean, just kind of let these words sink into your mind and think about the drama in verses 24 through 26. When her days to be delivered were fulfilled, behold, there were twins in her womb. And the first one came out red all over like a hairy garment. And they called his name Esau, because Esau means red. Verse 26, and after that came his brother out, and his hand, Jacob's brother, the twin, his hand took hold on Esau's heel, and his name was called Jacob. I'll guarantee you, no OBGYN has ever seen anything like this, ever. I mean, can you imagine the midwives scratching their heads, saying, what in the world's going on? Esau comes out red all over and covered with hair. That's what the Bible says. And then one of the midwives looks over and she says, man, what's that? And the little brother has his heel gripped tightly like he's trying to pull him back inside the womb. I mean, this was a dramatic birth that was going on. So the little boys are born, they are given the names. And the second thing that we see here is a remarkable contrast. Verses 27 and 28. The boys grew. Esau was a cunning hunter, a man of the field. Jacob was a plain man, dwelling in tents. Isaac loved Esau because he did eat his venison, but Rebekah, she loved Jacob. Now, I think that we would say, probably those of us who have multiple children, that all children are different. Man, I know mine are. Mine are vastly different. And I wonder sometimes, how did these three come from the same mama and daddy? They are so different. And yet I want to tell you, we'd have to search far and wide to find any two brothers as vastly different as Esau and Jacob were. Not only were they different in their looks, but they were also different in their personalities. Now, the Bible says that Esau was a skilled hunter. He was an outdoorsman. Says that Jacob was a quiet man, and he liked to just hang around in the tent. Bible said of Esau that he liked to be outside all the time, work in the fields, go hunt wild game. In fact, it said that he even smelled of the field. Now, you may not have been able to see him coming, but you could smell him coming. He had the field all over him. But now Jacob was a mama's boy. Jacob would rather stay at home and help his mama bake cookies and, you know, cook the evening meal. So here you have a man's man, and here you have a mama's boy. I mean, they were radically different. And something that always sticks out when we study this text is that the parents' conduct here furthered the divide between these two boys. Because the Bible says that Isaac loved Esau, but Rebekah loved Jacob. Now, I'm sure that both of these parents loved both of these boys. There's no doubt in my mind of that. And yet, one played favorites with one, and the other parent played favorites with the others. And don't you think for a minute that those boys didn't know that. Esau knew that Jacob was mama's favorite. He knew that. Jacob knew that Esau was daddy's favorite. And friend, I want to tell you, one of the quickest ways to tear up a home is to let parents show favoritism in that home toward their children. You just let the parents do that. You know, why can't you make A's like your brother? Why can't you obey like your sister? Why can't you clean up your room always like, you know, the other boy does? Those are destructive words, dangerous words, damning words. I tell you, every little boy and girl needs to grow up in a home that feels like they are equally loved by mama and by daddy. And it's not based upon their actions. It's not conditioned upon anything. It's just a simple fact. They're loved because they are their children. And so we see this remarkable contrast. But then the third thing that we see in verses 29 through 34, which really is what I wanted to strongly emphasize in our study tonight, is a shameful exchange. A shameful exchange. Let me read these verses again. Jacob sod, or he cooked pottage, or a pot of stew beef is the way we would put it. So Jacob was cooking this pot of stew beef. Esau came in from the field, and he was faint. Esau said to Jacob, "Feed me, I pray thee, with that same red pottage, for I'm faint." Therefore was his name called Edom. And Jacob said, "Sell me this day thy birthright." And Esau said, "Behold, I am to the point of death. What profit shall this birthright be to me if I'm dead tomorrow?" And Jacob said, "Swear to me this day." And he sware unto him. And he sold his birthright unto Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and pottage of lentils, and he did eat and drink, rose up and went his way. And thus Esau despised his birthright. Now, friend, let me just kind of tell you that story again, put it in language we can understand, and then come back and make the spiritual application. The Bible says Esau had been out in the field. He'd been hunting all day. He was worn out, weary, tired, exhausted, hungry. Came home, when he walked inside the tent, he smelled that pot of stew that his brother Jacob was cooking, and his stomach began to growl. And he said to his brother Jacob, give me some of this stew. He said, I'm to the point that I'm going to die if I don't get something to eat. Now, that was a lie. He wasn't about to die. I mean, he was the grandson of Abraham. And I'll guarantee you that no grandson of Abraham did without the necessities of life. It wasn't that he was about to die. It's just that that's what he wanted. He was hungry, and he wanted some stew beef. And Jacob, seizing on the moment, said, "Oh, you'll do anything for a bowl of this stew, huh? Yeah, I'll do anything." And he said, "All right then, brother, sell me your birthright, and then you can have some of this stew beef." And he said, "I'll do it. what good is this birthright if I'm going to famish and starve to death anyway? I'll be dead. And so the Bible says that he gave, he sold him his birthright, and then he gave him that stew to eat. Now let me tell you something about the birthright. I won't take the time to read the scriptures, but if you're taking notes and you want to study the birthright, Deuteronomy 21:17 and 1 Chronicles chapter 5 verses 1 and 2. But a birthright was important to that day. A birthright involved both material and spiritual blessings. The one that received the birthright, that boy received twice as much property as any of the other sons. The one that received the birthright became the head of the family and the spiritual leader of his people. That was involved in the birthright. And in this case, it meant the one that was in the line that was going to produce the Messiah. Friend, that's what he gave up. That's what he sold. And I call this a shameful exchange because both of these boys, I believe, committed a shameful act. There was Jacob, and we learn from Jacob's life that it was marked by scheming. Friend, why did Jacob do that? God had already promised and guaranteed him both the birthright and the blessing. He didn't have to scheme around and trick his brother to get it. God had already promised him that it was going to be his. But no, he had to live a scheming life. I saw a plaque one time that said that faith is living without scheming. Too bad Jacob didn't have that one hanging in his bedroom. He didn't have to scheme to get it. All he had to do was believe God and trust God. In God's timing, God would have brought it to pass. You know, here's the classic example of going after the right thing the wrong way. You know, the right thing was to have the birthright. I commend him for wanting that. But God had already promised it to him. But man, oh, Esau. Now here's the guy we really learned something from. If Jacob was a scheming man, Esau was a shallow man. Verse 32, and Esau said, behold, I am at the point to die. What profit shall this birthright do me? In other words, listen, he gave little thought to spiritual things. All he was concerned about was the here and now. The birthright was a blessing for the future. He didn't care about the future. All he cared about was right now. I'm going to tell you, what we read in verse number 34 is the motto of our day in our culture. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and pottage of lentils. He did eat and drink. Isn't that the motto of our day? Just eat, drink, and be merry. Live it up right now. Have a good time today. Just worry about today. And leave spiritual things aside. Friend, did you know that because of his disregard for spiritual things, that the Bible's commentary on Esau's life, it's not very favorable? Because he said, you know what, I'm not interested in these spiritual things, I'm interested in the material, something to eat and something to drink. Listen to what the Bible said about him in Hebrews chapter 12, verses 15 through 17. Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled, lest there be any fornicator or profane person as Esau. Now, friend, we read nothing in the Genesis narrative that says that Esau was a profane person. But evidently, according to God's perspective, it was a profane thing to do to despise the birthright. He said he was a profane person as Esau, who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. For you know how that afterward he would have inherited the blessing, but he was rejected, for there was found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears. Friend, I want to tell you one of the reasons why I believe that the Bible is so hard on Esau is because Esau rejected the many spiritual advantages that belong to him. Esau wasn't the son of a pagan king. He was a son of Isaac, the grandson of Abraham. My stars, think about the spiritual advantages that he was raised up with. And yet, though even he was raised up around all of that, had so much opportunity to live his life for the glory of God, he sold it all for a mess of pottage. And the Bible said he was a profane person for doing that. I want to tell you, verse 34, the C part of that verse, is one of the most powerful statements in the Bible. When it says that he rose up, went his way, and when he did that, he despised his birthright. Man, that word despise, that's a nasty word, isn't it? Ever say of anybody, man, I despise that person? Had anyone ever said about you? Just despise you. He despised his birthright. Now put this in context and let me make the application. What was he despising? The advantages God had placed before him. To know him, to love him, to serve him, to walk with him, to grow in him, to be a man of God. When he just rejected all that, neglected it, and resisted, God said, "You are despising my gifts." Now, friend, I want to tell you, you put that in the context of being born and raised in the United States of America, when there are spiritual advantages everywhere. And if God said that about Esau then, who had nothing like we have now, what will he say about the person that rejects the Lord, or the saved person that does not take advantage of the spiritual advantages God has placed around that saved person to grow in the Lord and to be a man and a woman of God? What's he going to say to that person? What are some of the advantages that we have that Esau didn't have? How about the benefits of the Bible? Esau didn't have a Bible. In fact, there was no such thing as a codified scripture, not even a beginning of it until 500 years later in the time of Moses. He didn't have a Bible. My stars, we got more than we want. Bible's on sale in every bookstore on the corner. You can get a Bible in any translation that you want it. You can get it in large print, giant print, regular print. If you're blind, you can even get it in Braille. Bibles everywhere. Not only Bibles, how about the commentaries, the study aids, the word study books, the encyclopedias, the dictionaries? What in the world? And listen, I know that not I'm preaching to the choir, but what in the world do you think God's going to say to the person who accepts the free gift of his saving grace and yet never takes advantage of the resource of God's Word to treasure it in his or her heart and life, put it in their soul, grow in the Lord as the result of the study of the Word when it's so available and yet it's never opened? Probably the greatest dust storm that could ever be would be for Christians to pick up their Bibles and blow the dust off. You know, how many just kind of leave their Bibles in the car on Sunday and they pick it back up the next Sunday? Friend, the Bible is a treasure. When the moderator of the Church of Scotland participates in the coronation service of a king or a queen of England, he presents that new monarch with a Bible and says these words: "The most precious thing this world affords, the most precious thing that this world knows, God's living Word." End of quote. It is precious. Friend, I'm telling you, and I say this with a burden, God's not going to go light at the judgment seat of Christ on Christians who have God's Word and so many resources to study God's Word and yet die in spiritual ignorance. God's not going to go light on us if we're like that. So there's the benefits of the Bible, the benefits of gospel preaching. That's what we have in our land. I know that preaching's not that good today. As a matter of fact, there is no one who is more pained over the deplorable state of Bible preaching than I am today. You hear bad preaching all over the place. I've done a lot of it myself. And yet preaching is the way that God has chosen to win people to Christ and to grow them in the Lord. Man, we have the television, we have radio, you know, traveling from town to town or state to state. We have AM radio, FM radio, satellite radio, and anywhere you want, you can find gospel preaching. And that's one of God's gifts, isn't it? That's one of those spiritual advantages, is gospel preaching. And yet so many, unlike you tonight, are at home in the lazy boy, doing so many other things, neglecting gospel preaching and teaching, when three-quarters of the world don't have the blessing we do right here. God's not going to go light at the judgment seat of Christ for those that neglect gospel preaching. How about the benefits of the church? I know the church isn't perfect, but man, the church is still God's church. And once again, like the Bible, they're everywhere, aren't they? I mean, you got big churches, small churches, liturgical churches, informal churches, traditional churches, non-traditional churches. Any kind of church you want, you can find. And yet so many people, as I mentioned in my sermon this last Sunday morning, the average member of an evangelical church attends 53% of the time. I don't think that's acceptable before God. R.C. Sproul, I read a story that he was telling of, he was teaching at a conference at, I can't think of the name of the college, but it was about 30 miles from where he lived, and so he decided he would just ride the city bus there and back. And it was late at night, and he was on that city bus. He was coming back to his home, and he said it was the bus went through several little small mill towns in Pittsburgh where he lived. And he said you would see the filth and the dirt and the trash out on the streets, and people just looking so hopeless. He said inside the bus, people that were going to the mill to work and getting off work and going back home were riding that bus. And he sat at the back and looked into their faces, and he said they were so discouraged and depressed. No one was talking to anybody. And he just said, I just said in my soul, God, is there any hope for these people? And he said, no longer had I said that until we passed by a little storefront church. It had a little neon light across in the window. And he said, I think I'll just, you know, play a game, and I'll see how much further we have to go before we need to see another church. He said, we didn't go another block, and there was another church. Didn't go another block, and there was another church. And he said, Lord, that's the hope. That's what you have placed in our culture, to be hope for people. And yet, especially in the Bible Belt of the South, where those churches are on every street corner, and I think that those that neglect that advantage, the Lord's not going to be pleased with. Let me mention one more advantage. How about the benefits of time? I say to you, and you may disagree, and be wrong if you want to, but I say to you that we have more time today, more leisure time, than any generation that's ever lived. No, Pastor, I'm busy. Well, most of our business is doing something we want to do. Now, I'm going to tell you, a generation before us, they knew nothing about a 40-hour work week. They worked from sun up to sundown 6 days a week just to survive. And most people in our culture work 40 hours a week, and the rest of it's just leisure time. So what do we do with this advantage that God has given to us? The average American watches 5 hours of television a day. A day. Or do we use that leisure time to seek the Lord, to pray, to study His Word, to grow?
I'm just asking this, are we taking advantage of the spiritual advantages? Because when we do not take advantage of the many advantages for spiritual growth, according to this text, we are despising God's gifts, despising those gifts. I remember a guy in my hometown. He was a very wealthy man, also a very respected man. He was a good man, very good man. And he made his fortune in the logging business. Had a big, huge home way out in the country. Had one son. And I grew up with that son. And his plan was he was going to leave all of his wealth and everything to that one boy. He wanted that boy to go to college to get a business degree and then take over the family business and continue it to grow it. Continue to grow it. But that boy, he didn't have a lick of initiative. He was lazy. Couldn't get him to do anything. He barely got out of high school, much less went to college. Last time or time before last when we were home, I ran into one of my friends and I asked him about this boy that had been so advantaged. And he told me, he said, he's nothing but a drunk. And he spends most of his time down at the Pines Bar, a little bar down the street. Now here was a guy who had such an advantage, but he didn't take advantage of his advantages. Now, friend, I want to tell you, let's look at all that we have, all of the opportunities to grow in the Lord. Say, thank you, Lord, for that gift. Help me to use it wisely. Would you stand, please? And our Father, we thank you that when you save us, Lord, you bless us. So many things that will help us to grow in you and mature in you, become conformed into the very image of Christ. And Lord, I'm not talking tonight about living a perfect life. I know, Lord, that none of us will ever do that. But I pray that if there are some areas in my life, in the lives of the dear folks here tonight, that we're not taking advantage of, that we're using simply for a purpose to gratify the flesh, when it could be used as a purpose or to be filled with the Spirit. I pray that you would point those areas of our lives out to us so that, Lord, we would not be like Esau and be guilty of despising the birthright. Lord, it's such a blessing to be born in this amazing nation that we live in. Lord, we could have been born in Afghanistan or Iraq, Iran, under some militant Islamic dictatorship. But God, we were born here in a free nation. And Lord, we know that with this great privilege comes an awesome responsibility. So I pray that we would be grateful recipients of your gifts and good stewards of them. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you.